So today I will just focus, you know, I was asked to focus actually on the National Single Window implementation in relation actually to Article 10, Section 4 of the WTO TFA. Okay? And of course, if any one of you later, you know, you want to ask me about regional single window, I'm happy to share with you. Because, in fact, if you look at it, even though it's all single window, there will tend to be some difference, you know, when you implement at the national level and also at the regional level. Okay, let's move on. I'll try, in fact, to cut out some of the time so that I think we can have a little break for lunch. So roughly, I will give, of course, a very brief introduction, and I will tell you about a slide, you know, how our national single window in Malaysia has evolved until today, since day one. And of course, you know, I cannot forget that, you know, my task is to actually to tell you how actually how the Malaysian single window has, you know, is able to comply, okay, the Article 10.4 of the WTO TFA. And I think there's also another important area that I was asked to share is the challenges and the success factors. I think most of you, especially when you are at the initial stage of implementation or even at the stage that you are looking at, you know, to implement a national single window, I think you would like to know, you know, the challenges, so that also you won't what you call you learn from some of our mistakes, or no, the lessons learned from us. And I will, of course, tell you briefly know how Malaysia is moving forward, and at the same time I will also maybe, you know, indicate to you how, you know, you can also move forward. Okay. Now, just to tell you that, you know, in Malaysia, some of our main drivers, I think that is very important, right? So the main drivers in Malaysia for the national single window is, of course, the lead agency is the Ministry of Finance, yeah? And the implementing agency is actually Customs, right? Because Customs is playing a very important role in the custom clearance, yeah? And of course, you know, the Ministry of Trade is very important. They are actually the oversight agency. And I'm sure that last yesterday and also this morning, somebody was talking about whether what you call the Trade Facilitation Committee and the National Single Window Committee, can it be the same or is what? So here you can see that actually our Ministry of Trade has the Trade Facilitation Action Council. They are actually the agency that what you call develop all the trade policy and whatnot, right? So in fact, they play a very important role in the NSW implementation. But later on, you'll see that which of the what you call the how would I say it, the those working group or committee, you know, that was set, you know, to implement the NSW, where they are, the Ministry of Trade. Okay. And of course, we have here one of the private sector, that is DNT, the Daganet Technology Private Limited company, is actually a government link company. They are actually the WAN provider, and also the NSW operator. So you'll find that it is more like a public-private kind of initiative for NSW. So now, what is important, I think, even like Indonesia has shared, you see, why they redefine actually the definition of single window, because actually it's objective. What is the objective of the national single window? So for us, it's actually to enhance the trade efficiency and the national competitiveness through simplifying, standardizing and harmonizing trade procedure and government delivery system. And of course, you know, like you have seen, you know, Indonesia, you can see also all the back end, you know, and all the agencies have implemented, you know, their various kind of systems, you know. So you have to integrate, right? Integrate and then provide a seamless platform for the national single window. And at the same time, because in ASEAN, we are also implementing the ASEAN single window. So one of the very important objectives for Malaysia, you know, as one of the pilot country, you know, one of the six that, you know, participate in the ASEAN single window pilot project, we have to have provide a seamless platform for the ASEAN single window for data exchange. So now, this is how, you know, our national single window in Malaysia evolved. It is actually way back in 1995, there was no such thing as single window, right? They were talking about EDI, right? So it all started in 1995. We have EDI, you know, initiative. We call it the Custom Information System. That's in short, is CIS, the Dagana Interface System, intermediate in 1995, to allow electronic data exchange between our CIS. CIS is actually our custom back-end processing system. Okay, and so it interfaced with the system that provided by the VAN provider, the value added network. So it started from there. And if you look at that time, you know, if you look at also, I think UN, ECE, one of the case study of single window, and Malaysia together with Singapore, I think we were there as one of the pioneers that, you know, implemented a single window. If you look at it, you know, it gel with the actually recommendation 33, where you have a single entry point, you know, for your custom decoration and whatnot. So basically, at that time, you know, it is some sort of like a single window, because they were talking about single entry point, right? So from there, of course, you know, when the single window kind of concept approach came in, you know, so we evolved and we try and look at those what you call expect, you know, that the at that time, you know, how people look at NSW. So our NSW actually was implemented based on the existing, you know, EDI infrastructure provided by the WAN provider, and then after that we enhance it to support more and more what you call facility and you know, features to support in view of the ASEAN single window implementation. So it is quite what you call a long process in that sense, right? So this is just to give you a rough idea, you know, how we started our EDI system, you know, with the value-added network provided in the middle, and you have the trading partners who are all the port operator, shipping agent, you know, the forwarding agent or custom broker, and of course you have the bank, because for the payment of our what you call duty payment, and of course other OGA, including those permit issuing agency, and also those agency that will give the approval at the point of entry, like the quarantine, you know, agency and whatnot. And of course, on the other hand, will be the CIS system. Now, when we migrate to the National Single Window platform, now, in 1995, we don't have much on what you call internet kind of transaction, right? So as technology progress and all these things, of course, when you talk about national single window, a lot of people will be are looking at internet connectivity, you see, so that you can launch it anywhere you want and at any time. So here in the NSW, we have actually, of course, launched our My Trade Link portal. You can actually go to the internet and search for it, and you can go and have a look at our national single window portal. So basically, you look at it, you know, we are linking, you know, providing this user interface to the internet, web-based application and whatnot. And at the same time, we still have our old customs information at the back there to process all this decoration. Okay, so basically, if you look at the national single window, a lot of people, you know, especially at the policy maker and the higher level, they can't imagine it. They always equate it with maybe with a one-stop standard manually. That is the easiest way for them to compare. Okay, where you have a national single window, maybe it's a centralized system, everybody is accessing it, and everything is processing at the national single window. But if you look at it, even if you look at the previous presentation by Indonesia, you can see that at the back, actually, there are a lot of this back-end system. You know, they are not actually one system, and they are not developed by one single developer. You know, but they have to integrate it. So that's why the importance of the your national single window is an objective. You see, you have looked at Indonesia, you know, what is their objective? They are working towards this. And their single window, you know, provide you a lot of information, you know, management tracking and whatnot. So likewise, it's the same thing in Malaysia. You know, we have our back end. Malaysia, Malaysian Customs is, has actually their own back end system. You see, but at the same time, you have the My Trading Portal, where you know the trader can log on to the internet, and you have the web based kind of web form. You know that you can launch it. You know, so now here I give you an overview of the portal, and this is just an example. There's no fix and fast rule how you want to secure your different layer of your system. So this basically I would like to show you is that now you have an NSW portal, okay? And this is the layer that you can provide a lot of these services and facility to your trader. So you have to know what your traders are looking at, okay? Looking for. Like of course those like a tariff and no information and whatnot, you have to provide them. It's just like information. But at the same time, I know that in ASEAN also we are also each of our member state is encouraged to develop the national trade repository, which actually Indonesia has also shown you about simulation for the trader. When you want to import, let's say certain commodity, you can just put in the tariff code of that commodity, and the application is able to tell you what are the permit that may be required, the license and whatnot, and what are the duty involved and all the procedure there. So this is actually what ASEAN is also looking at to encourage members to look at that kind of facility to be provided by the National Single Window. And at the end of the day, we are also looking at the ASEAN level how to integrate this national trade repository into the ASEAN trade repository. And this is still underway. Huh? So it, of course, is coordinated by our ASEAN secretariat. Okay, so now you look at this layer, you see you have a back office. This, I'm only showing you the back office of customs. Now, you look at permit issuing agency, they will also have their back end, right? So you see for customs, for the permit to be able to use by customs, of course, you must have the exchange of information, right? When you have a PIA, you process all your permit application and whatnot. That is actually not the concern of customs, right? What will be a concern of customs is, at the end of the day, your permit is able to be shared. So this is what the National Single Window is able to help you, right? So you have the PIA agency, you have your own backend, okay? You process, you have your own trader to apply for your permit and whatnot. Of course, that user interface, you can go through the NSW portal, okay? That means you have a single log-on, you are as a trader, you can log on to the National Single Window, and now I say that I want to apply for a permit. It still go through the same portal link, like my trade link, you apply for the permit, and automatically this system is able to channel it, the application to the right agency to process it. But at the end of the day, how you process it is actually is your back end. Okay, so when they approve it, the term permit, it will be routed to the relevant agency. It's transparent to the trader. It should be, right? How you do it, the trader actually shouldn't be in the know. So when I permit, the permit information should be given to customs. This is what we are doing. So we receive a copy of the permit from the PIA, the permit issuing agency. So and we have a copy. And when we process the custom declaration, then it's in the back end of our application that we will do validation. So this validation not necessary to be done at the portal, at the front end. I think as let's say a policy maker or whatever, you don't need to know, because your IT developer will know how to do it. They are fantastic, okay? IT is always very innovative. You just tell them what you require. This is the input. I want this, what the output that I want. And the IT people will do a fantastic job for you, how you must digest it, and they will give you the output. So as, let's say, a policy or a user, all you want, you should know is what you are having, your input, what is available, and what you are expecting at the end of the day. And your IT people should be able to do it for you. So this is basically the different layer that you can see. So to give you some idea that a single window, it is not something that like one side that everything is processed there, centralized, even your database, it is not necessary to be residing at your National Single Window. The data can be just still kept at your respective agency. Like the permit, you know, I don't need to have it, you see. So I just need a copy. Whatever that, you know, extra information or this thing, the PIA, you know, they may need it for their other, what you call, usage, you know, at the back end, it is kept with the PIA, okay? And the custom declaration, you know, all our information, all this thing, we don't need to, you know, provide upfront in the NSW database. No, it is kept with our back end, okay? So because the custodian of the what you call the trade data, the custom declaration is custom. So we have to be responsible for that. Okay. So now this is just a snapshot. You can go into this URL and you can have a look at it. You know, our national single window portal. Now this is what we have in Malaysia. When this is the setup, you know, of our committee and working group. So on top, of course, we have the steering committee, which is state chaired by our sec-gen of our treasury, and which is under the MOF. Now you must be wondering that now why Custom is not the lead agency. So we can see that, you see, because Custom is just at a department level. Okay, the agency, the ministry is at a higher level. Now you can see that, you know, some of the working group and whatnot, other parties involved are at the ministry level. So it is very difficult for Customs to be the head and coordinate. It's very difficult because we cannot call the shot. No, we are not high enough. So that's why in Malaysia we do is that we have our, because Customs is under Ministry of Finance. Okay, so what we do is that we have our Ministry of Finance, our higher level of official, to be the lead agency to make the what you call to drive it, okay? And of course, you know, and the custom is the implementing agency. So then under it, that we have the implementing committee. Committee is also under Ministry of Finance, okay? So it is the next level of official, okay? And then under the implementing committee, then we have all these working groups. Okay, to put in place. So this is, in fact, is to facilitate all the coordination, because you know, when you implement a single window at your national level, you need to have what you call the, there are many, you know, players, you know, to coming in. So this is the different role. I think you can read it. I'm not going to elaborate on each of the working group. So now, To talk about what you call in relation to your WTO TFA, the Article 10.4, talking about, I think Marcus also has mentioned about that. I'm not going to elaborate more on that. What I'm trying what I'm going to do is just to provide you information. You know, in Malaysia we have actually provided, you know, about, you know, six services, including the regional exchange gateway to the ASW. Compliant, you know, I mean, to support, you know, later on the implementation of this Article 10.4, okay? These are all the various services. Maybe the next few slides, I will just give you a brief, you know, what is this individual services that is provided under the our NSW. So under the e-declare, of course, is very obvious, for declaration, you know, they allow traders and custom broker and to submit the custom electronic declaration, and it is, of course, 24/7, because it's auto, you see, is not manually managed, driven. So, and then, of course, we have the registration and whatnot, and then all the, what you call responses, we have like physical examination, whatnot, then we'll channel it back to the national single window portal for tracking purposes and whatnot. And of course, the trader can also track, you know, the status of your declaration, whether it is already approved or is already payment receipt and is already a documentary release. And of course, we also have this payment system, and we cater for three modes. Basically, the very first traditional mode of payment is electronic fund transfer, which is actually under the EDI project at that time. And later on, of course, we move on to duty net, which there's an online based custom duty. This module is this mode is basically is to address the human intervention in the first traditional mode, in the sense that because for the EFT, you know, there's some what you call human intervention at the bank, that the bank because it is not linked to the bank system, because of the security, so the bank did not allow, you know, this online system to link directly to their back end, you know. So but for the duty net, yes, we have selected banks, and so we have a 24/7 kind of services. So because for the EFT, you know, like on Saturday and Sunday when the banks are not not open, and there will be a delay, you know, in the payment, so we move on the duty net, then we overcome that kind of issue. And later on, of course, we also have those like the banks, you know, they have their own association or whatnot, you know, they have their own maps, you know, those kind of system. So we move on even to link up the system with their network, their network, their connectivity, and to provide a better service. And here, just like I mentioned about permit, so this is where in the NSW, you know, we have this service to enable the trader to apply for the permit to the permit issuing agency, and a copy of that route to customs system. And of course, we have a 23 permit issuing agency, and we have actually 16 agency implemented paperless. Paperless in the sense that that means they don't need to print out anymore the permit. Some agency for certain purposes, you know, they still require the trader, you know, to have a paper permit, document. But for customs, we will look at our systems, you know, so they don't need to actually submit the paper document or permit to us, but it's for their own PIA purposes, you know, for other usage. And of course, we have, of course, the preferential certificate origin, the CO, and I think Indonesia just now mentioned about the Form D, you know, the Adhikar Form D, which actually a certificate CO, a preferential CO that used among all the ASEAN member states, that, you know, you will be granted a certain special duty rate, you know, if your products is originated from ASEAN. So this is the one that is actually being piloted at the ASEAN level as well. At the ASEAN level as well. And of course, we have the manifest, that is the cargo report, and you have all this system will allow user to apply for the ship call number, submit your vessel information, and to submit your actual time of arrival, and most important, of course, the bill of lading, the cargo report and whatnot. And this one, of course, when the customs receive this information, and we are checking against our declaration, that will be the back end processing. Now, I think this will be the last few slides on the challenges and success factor. So what I have done is that I have put it side by side, in the sense that I'm talking about, okay, the challenge, and if you look at the success factors, it's more or less like how actually you are able to overcome and address this challenge. So I will do it this way, okay? So now, the key challenge, of course, you know, I would say that is your drivers. Yeah, so it's top down. If you wait for, you know, like a bottoms up, it will never happen. Okay, you must have a political will and a commitment, and you must have the key drivers will also must be able to influence. Okay, the availability of your budget. Okay, right. And so, as I said, there are many players, you know, involved, and it require efficient coordination. And you'll notice that maybe even back in your own country, you know, if you look around the parties that are going to be involved in your national single window, they might not have the same level of computerization program, you see. So so to address all these challenges and all these things, so, you know, in order to implement the NSW in a more efficient way. So your political view and commitment in terms of national policy and financial support is very important. So that is one of the success factor. And of course, you have to identify, not only that, you have the driver. You, among the drivers, you have to identify a very strong lead agency. and ensure that all these players have a common understanding. So you cannot have an agency doesn't even understand and have the same understanding with the players. So how is he going to drive? So first thing, your driver, your lead agency must have a very clear vision and objective of what you want to achieve for your NSW. And the agency must make sure that all of the parties, you know, the agency involved must have the same understanding. Otherwise, when you come into the meeting and you want to drop your blueprint or roadmap, it will be all over. You know, it will be the direction will not be focused. And of course, you have to also establish the relevant bodies like what we have shown you, the steering committee and whatnot, the task force. So that one also is subject to your own capital. You know. Not necessarily exactly like what we have, you know, so many working groups, you know. And then, of course, you must have the relevant agency to carry out the business process re-engineering to streamline their respective business process. Now, here you are actually two parts, okay? The individual agency actually need to streamline your processes, right, to support your NSW. But now, while individual agency is encouraged to streamline your processes and to review it, do a PPR, there must be a lead agency to coordinate that, especially in the data harmonization and whatnot. You know, you will have, like, let's say, code, very simple. You know, one agency may use a different standard, their own standard, and code it for district and all these things, and you have another agency. So when you come to the NSW, you know, you don't have a simple, a harmonized code even for even your own province or your district and whatnot. You know, very simple. And even, yeah, like the ID of the party, you know, you have different format and all these things. So when you come into National Single Window, you know, how are you going to harmonize it? So in the process of, you know, doing the individual BPR, you know, at your individual agency level, so it will be good, you know, you have an agency to coordinate all these things. And finally, you know, that agency will have to harmonize all this, you know, data and whatnot. And so that is very important. That is what we learn. And also you have to, of course, identify the champion to coordinate this, like what I say. Okay, so the last two challenge I would like to share with you is to coping with changes to existing system is not an easy task. Okay, like I say, you know, you have different agency have different level of computerization. So when you say that you want to implement a single window, it might affect, you know, changes to the individual agency system, and reluctance to change is always there. Okay, so you need to have, you know, to establish an efficient, effective change management policy. Because when you individual member agency have changes also, it might also have some cost implication. They might also, you know, need some fund, you know, financial support. And this one will go back to your central agency that provide your finance, like in Malaysia, the MOF. Now, if MOF, you know, Ministry of Finance is not supportive of that, you know, you ask them to change, okay, to streamline. And these people say that, well, I need it, but I need money. And you are not going to provide, you know, for them the financial support and all this. How, you know, is the agency is going to change, you know? So all this, you know, is very important, okay? So now, lacking of ICT infrastructure, you know, like you see in Malaysia, we have another part of Malaysia, they call East Malaysia, the Sabah, Sarawak, you know, which are less developed. And they also have some location that, you know, the infrastructure is limited. You know, they don't have access of internet and whatnot. So all these things, you know, is tend to be some kind of obstacle in the sense that if you want to roll out 100% to the whole nation. So you have to actually, you know, look at the plan, how you want to address that. You have to work with the telecommunication, you know, organization to make sure that, you know, all these things in place, you know. So you need that, you know. Otherwise, you'll find that you can't roll out to, you know, all your ports and, you know, and all the custom offices, you know, for your paperless trade. Yeah? So you'll find that some of the office is still manual. You know, so they still have to, you know, have a manual document, and some of the of course, this one will take time. No? You cannot, like, you know, you will take time to roll out this, but you have to plan. You have to plan and address all these things. Before you go into that kind of location, you make sure that, you know, you must be able to address that for them. No? You cannot force something to them when you don't give them the facility. So basically, I think that's the important, I think, parts that I would like to share. So this is just a brief that how Malaysia is moving forward. Of course, you know, we are actually in the midst to revamp our Yeah, Felicia. Yeah. So this is this is my last slide. Okay. So this is how we are going to moving forward. And for you to move forward, you know, of course you will just look at the challenges and the success factor. I think that's how, you know, you are able to move forward and set it up. That's all. Okay. I think thank you very much. So.